dictated by limitations of the platform being used, Teams Q&A, Facebook, and YouTube. In-person comments will be accepted first, followed by comments submitted virtually. The meeting comment period is limited to a total of 30 minutes, including both in-person and virtual comments. This time period may be extended at the discretion of the board. Please be concise. Comments that are germane to county business will be read during the meeting and should not be considered to be interactive dialogue with the commissioners. The county solicitor should be the final arbiter of whether a comment is germane and should be read. Any commissioner response to public comment will be done at the discretion of the commissioners.
Thank you very much, Anne Marie. As I noted, we're here on the road on a Thursday evening in Anilani Township, not far from my home, but I think I was the last one here, so I don't know what my excuse was. But we really appreciate Anilani Township hosting us. This is the last on the road that we'll be doing this year in December. We'll be having an evening meeting, and that normally is the second Thursday in December where we'll be voting on the budget, but that meeting will be at the County Services Center. So at this time, I'd like to recognize Supervisor John Stein. Is it Steingraber? Joshua. Oh, well, I have John. So Joshua Steingraber, supervisor here in Anilani Township. Glad to have us, glad to be here and share what you would like to share.
Is it on now? I'm sorry. Kim even reminded me. Thank you all for being here. It's a pleasure to host all of you in our township. I've only been a supervisor for 3 years. I lived in this area for about 18 years now, but I got involved because of our local police department when we were having some instability with our neighbors. It got me involved, and that got figured out, and I was able to stay on the board and accomplish a lot of other goals that we've had here. I'm very happy that you're here. We have a fantastic township, and since I've been here, we've had a lot of growth. Kim Berger, our township administrator, was happy enough to write me some notes today because I'm a terrible speaker. I'm extremely nervous when I found out this was going to be on. Thank you. All right. No, thank you. I appreciate it. Anilani Township, my name is Joshua Steingraber. I'm one of three of the supervisors. Charles Grablowski, the gentleman over here, is our second, and we actually have a vacancy which we're going to be filling at our next meeting because a third supervisor stepped down. But as far as the township, just for people that are watching or for those of you that don't know a lot about Anilani, we were founded in 1850. We're about 9.2 square miles, and some of that is Anilani Lake, which, by the way, is a water source for us and a lot of the city of Reading as well. We have some construction going on. Anybody that was coming north on Route 61 saw the construction over here. One of them is a 600-some-square-thousand-foot warehouse that's going to be, let me see here, it's going to be a S&S Activewear, whatever that means, I'm not sure, but they're gracious enough to come into our area. The other site that you see being built here is going to be the future home of Right Now or Trucking. It's a large trucking manufacturer. I think it's one of the largest in the nation for aluminum truck trailers. We have some road construction because of that they're going to be doing to widen the intersections down here. Some of the other things we're doing is down here on Bowers Road. If anyone's familiar with Anilani Lake and the old Blue Falls Grove, there was a small dirt road coming down through there. So we are improving that with grants that we've gotten. One of the other large things we're doing is we don't have our own wastewater treatment plant, but we share with Leesport Borough Municipal Authority. And the county was gracious enough to give us about $230,000 of ARPA money. We thank you. This goes a long way because we're responsible for about 40% of the upgrades, and it does get expensive. But those are being done because of the commercial properties and residential properties are being built. So again, that's pretty much what's going on in our township. We thank you for being here, and thank you for the assistance that you give us, and enjoy your night.
Thank you.
Thank you for your service. One of the things a lot of people don't know, and I'm looking at Joe, he does, we're in a full-time position, and believe me, it's full-time work, but township supervisors, they don't even really get paid part-time. They get a stipend, and yet the people that elect you Many times they're your neighbors. You may go to church with them. You see them in the grocery store. They expect you to do what you need to do to run the township. And I want to thank you for your service and recognize it's a very significant job and it takes a lot of time and commitment.
Yeah, the 153 a month does not cover all our meetings. And, you know, yeah, another thing we did since I started here is we created a public works department. We had a part-time road crew, and we were able to create a three-man full-time road position for all of them for the township without having to raise taxes, by the way, to serve our community better. But we had a lot of meetings when we did that, to hire staff, equipment, policy manuals. Yeah, 153 did not help. So yeah, this and it's the same for everybody else in small municipalities. Sure. It's the people that are doing this, whether you like them or not. It costs you money to do this. So I do, you know, we do it. I do it. Chuck does it because, you know, we care about where we live. So
the other development that you have, I'd be interested in hearing, is St. Luke's. That's right, a property that was sitting for a long time. I believe there was a period of time, a Weiss Market was planned to go in there, but St. Luke's, it's not just an urgent care, it's a pretty significant facility.
Yeah, along with the Starbucks as well. Yeah, that's
more important.
Yeah, well, to some people that are traveling that road, yeah, but no, there's a large St. Luke's facility going in there, which is nice for that section that we borrow, we border with Leesport Borough. So yeah, that's fantastic for the corridor that we have here.
John, what's the population of your township?
About 2,600 people.
Thank you.
Like 2598 is what the census of 2020 said.
So what's your annual budget?
Kim, what is our annual budget?
The person with all the answers.
She is. 2.8 million.
Well, very good. And again, thank you for hosting us here this evening.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Continuing with our agenda, are there any additions or corrections for the September 19th meeting minutes? Hearing none, the minutes will stand approved as presented. We did have an executive session on September the 25th dealing with litigation, personnel, and contract negotiations. There's no public comment on agenda items in person. Any public comment on agenda items online? Nothing online. We will move into our agenda. Item one, authorizing under that budget department, adopt a resolution authorizing 2024 budget transfers in the amount of $20,000 per listing dated September the 20th of 2024. One item listed under purchasing, adopt a resolution authorizing the establishment of a micro purchase threshold higher than the federal threshold established in the federal acquisition regulations. By the way, if you want to know what this means, talk to our solicitor. I've read it several times. I have a general idea, but this is fairly complicated. Established in the federal acquisition regulations in accordance with the Code of Federal Regulations, this resolution shall serve as the county's self-certification to establish a micro-purchase threshold of $50,000. This threshold shall only be applicable in such cases the procurement of the required goods and services under the county code for third-class counties has a higher purchase threshold than the amount identified under another section or has no threshold, those purchases of goods or services considered to be exempt under the code. This self-certification is being established for a one-year term and shall be effective October 21st of 2024. Property goods and or services purchased utilizing federal funds shall continue to follow the greater, more stringent of the following requirements, and it cites the code referenced as the uniform guidance. You want to dive in there at all? That is quite unusual. Just wanted you to know if you thought it was confusing. It is, but I'm assured it is correct. Human resources, there are several items. Item one, authorize the appointment of Sarah McAndrew to Law Clerk 1, Court Administration. Item two, authorize the appointment of Joshua Williams to Project and Operations Manager, Facilities and Operations. Item three, authorize the promotion of Aaron Hengst from Internal Auditor to Senior Internal Auditor in the Controller's Office. There's one item listed under myself. adopt a resolution authorizing the appointment of Ryan Breisch, Thinking Spring, Pennsylvania, to the Berks County Public Libraries Advisory Board for a 3-year term effective January the 1st of 2025 and ending December 31st of 2027. There are two items listed under Commissioner Rivera. Item A, adopt a resolution authorizing the appointment of Elizabeth Mateo, PhD, Y Missing PA, to the Council on Chemical Abuse Board of Directors with the term ending on December 31st of 2026. Item B, adopt a resolution authorizing the appointment of Gaten T. Giannini, he has a doctorate, Telford, PA, to the South Central Transit Authority, BARTA, with the term ending on December 31st of 2028. Under the commissioners, several items are listed. Adopt a resolution authorizing the execution of the county assurance of financial commitment and participation for Children and Youth Services needs-based budget for the fiscal year 2025-2026. Item B, adopt a resolution authorizing Brian Gottschall, Director of Emergency Services, to electronically execute the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania State Fiscal Year 2024-2025 Hazardous Material Response Fund Grant Agreement. Item C, adopt a resolution authorizing the appointment of Lynette Gelsinger, Warnersville, Pennsylvania, as the Farmer Director to the Berks County Conservation District for a 4-year term beginning January the 1st of 2025 and ending December 31st of 2028. Item D, adopt a resolution authorizing the chair to execute the state food purchase program expense and data report for fiscal year 2023-2024 for Helping Harvest Fresh Food Bank. Item E, adopt a resolution authorizing the Board of Commissioners to execute the first amended and restated grant of conservation easement and a declaration of covenants, including the grant of conservation easement on additional land between the County of Berks and Third Place Holdings LLC and Berks Nature, and further authorizing the chair to execute the baseline data report addendum and authorizing Kevin S. Barnhart, Chief Operations Officer, or in his absence, Larry Medaglia, Deputy Chief Operations Officer, to execute additional documents necessary to amend the conservation easement subject to final review and approval by the Berks County Solicitor's Office. Item F, adopt a resolution authorizing the chair to execute the application for a local share account category 4 grant of $61,468.94 on behalf of Berks County Parks and Recreation Department from the Commonwealth Finance Authority to be used for redecking and other improvements to the Berks Leisure Area Iron Bridge located on 1901 Topahawken Road, Y Missing PA 19610, and further authorizing Kevin S. Barnhart, Chief Operations Officer, in his absence, Larry Medaglia, Deputy Chief Operations Officer, to execute all future documents and agreements between the County of Berks and the Commonwealth Finance Authority in connection with the grant. Item G, adopt a resolution authorizing the chair to execute the application for a local share account category 4 grant of $138,612.46 on behalf of the Schuylkill River Greenways Association from the Commonwealth Finance Authority to be used for the Toon Trail improvements, and further authorizing Kevin S. Barnhart, Chief Operations Officer, and in his absence, Larry Medaglia, Deputy Chief Operations Officer, to execute all future documents and agreements between the County of Berks and the Commonwealth Financing Authority in connection with the grant. Item two, a motion to authorize the execution of contract agreements and amendments as set forth on the contract agenda listing dated September the 23rd of 2024. There are a total of 4 contracts, one with the Berksheim, one with Children and Youth Services, one with HR, one with MHDD. And then item three, a motion to authorize the execution of payments and electronic transfers for the week ending September 27th of 2024. And I'm assuming something's missed. Did I jump over that? Okay. I missed item four under human resources, and I see why I did. Okay. Item four, authorized salary modifications for the following law clerks in court administration is listed. Their names are Valerie Kramer, Law Clerk 1, Matthew Cole, Law Clerk 1, Miki I'm not exactly how to say the name, so I'm not even going to try. I apologize. It's O-N-W-U-D-I-N-G-O, Law Clerk 1. Thank you for picking that up. Jumped right over that. That brings us to the end of the published agenda.
Motion to approve the agenda as presented.
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? The motion is carried. With that, we'll move to reports of our treasurer and controller. Our treasurer, Mitch Darcourt, was not able to make it, so I will read the report. The general account total balance is $256,524,392.82. There's a balance to clear of $4,347,854.30. That leaves a balance of $252,176,538.58. And with that, we'll go to our Berks County Controller, Mr. Joe Rutterow, who is here with us. Joe, the Controller's report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For the week ending 9/26/2024, we have a total accounts payable of $7,188,236.17. We have a total payroll of $5,200,448.63. For a total cash disbursement of $12,388,684.80. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and thank you for taking the time out of your evening to be here. I'm going to take a sidestep and recognize Jess Weeknecht, our Chief Human Resource Officer. She comes to virtually every one of the on-the-road meetings. I think she's here to keep an eye on us. Any problems we might cause, but we really appreciate her leadership. She is a part of our leadership team along with the COO team and our solicitor. We appreciate that. I also want to recognize Stephanie Williams. She's the director of the Berks County Library System, and really appreciate the work that she does with, and I always get it wrong, 23. Local municipal libraries that are part of the system. There are some libraries that are independent and not part of the system. So thank you very much for being here. With that, I'll move to our Deputy Chief Operations Officer, Larry Medaglia.
Thank you. Good evening, commissioners.
Good evening.
I'd like to, on behalf of the COO team, just offer an update on a couple of projects that are well underway. Phase two of the project at the Agricultural Center is moving along very well. We had a meeting out there today. For folks who may not be aware, when all is completed at the Ag Center, we will be home to the USDA, the Conservation District, Penn State Extension, the County Department of Agriculture, the coroner's office, the district attorney's detective's forensics unit, and our solid waste authority will be housed there as well. This is the first significant renovation to the Agricultural Center since 1973 when the facility was built. It was, I don't want to say overdue, but it certainly was ready for a refresh.
It reminded me of elementary school.
Or the Brady Bunch, kind of. It was just that kind of thing. So we're really pleased that the Board of Commissioners has made the investment and the commitment to that building and to the departments that are housed out there. At our South Campus in Moton, for people that don't know, the former Gytronics building where they had both a plant and offices, the county now has our South Campus there. Phase two of the renovations are well underway at that location. When that is all completed, we'll be home to the county archives, a portion of the Election Services Department, County Redevelopment Authority, and MDJ Dave Yock. Those departments are already there. We're looking towards next spring when we will be able to welcome the Area Agency on Aging, our Economic Development Office, the Industrial Development Authority, our Workforce Development Office, the Planning Commission, and the County Assessment Office. These are projects that the Board of Commissioners agreed to undertake, and it's a major commitment, I believe, to the county and to its residents. Being able to serve our public for well many years into the future. And I think that's something the public ought to be aware of. As I said, it was something that you could have said, well, we're not going to do that, but you made the commitment, and it's that kind of thing, along with the proposed projects and renovations downtown at the Services Center and the courthouse, that are going to allow county government and our public to be served well into the future. So thank you for that. If you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them.
I might add, we're doing this without building any new buildings. We looked very carefully, probably 3-4 years ago. Actually, it's more than that. We on the Ag Center, or probably closer to 7, when we did a study to see what made sense to build new or to take what was there and renovate it to make it fit our needs. And it wasn't even close. It was much more cost effective. And anyone that's been involved in new construction know how expensive it's gotten, especially since the pandemic. So what we're doing is necessary, but it also is being done as efficiently as possible. The moves are based on a study done by an outside firm that looked at all of the space we had and answered the question, what is the highest and best use? What is the most efficient use of that space? And where should various departments be based on the level of interaction with the public? That's one of the reasons, and I happen to know that Commissioner Rivera was one of the instigators behind it, but the data backed it up, that aging was moved from the 8th floor of the County Services Center in downtown Reading, which is relatively difficult for our aging population to access, to the South Campus, free parking, very easy to get to, on level, just a very good setup. So at the end, when all the pieces are moved, we don't need to build any new buildings. We're able to fully utilize the space we have and better use the space downtown. Once these groups and departments are moved out of the downtown, assessments being moved out, the economic development teams are ready down there, but the IDA is being moved, it will free up space to more efficiently utilize the space in both the courthouse and the service center, but it impacts the service center to a greater degree. So just so people understand, that's what this is, all a chessboard. None of this is done by itself without consideration for the impact on other departments and other aspects of the county. And the commissioners have been very involved in it leading up to it. And even though Commissioner Santoni is new, we're kept in the loop on the steps and where things are. You know, if challenges come up, we're notified about those as well. So any other comments, questions, anything else, Larry?
Thank you.
Okay. That quickly, we are to commissioners' comments, and I'll turn to Commissioner Michael Rivera for your comments.
Thank you, Commissioner Leinbach. Just a few comments here. I want to thank the township for opening the doors here to us tonight. It's, I don't know how many years I've been driving by here. Both of my kids graduated from Schuylkill Valley, so literally across the street here, and I don't think I've ever been in this building. So it's great to be here for the first time. I have seen the building many, many, many times. A beautiful building. Again, thank you for having us here today. A few other things. This past Tuesday, Commissioner Santoni and I attended a town hall in Fleetwood, in the Fleetwood, I guess you would call it, the municipal building where the library is at and the community center. We had different topics there, about 10 to 12 people there, spend an hour and a half listening to the concerns of the community and answering their questions. This is a part of town halls that we do on a monthly basis, except over summer and over in December. But we coordinate with the library, and what Stephanie does is she finds a library for us in different parts of the county, and we go out once a month to give a 5 to 10 minute update, each one of us, as to what's happening in the county. And then we open it up really for any questions. And on Tuesday, we had a multitude of questions there, a multitude of discussions. Some had to do with county government, other had to do with the state government and the federal government. But we were there to listen, answer questions, and provide any input that we can to the citizens that were there. The other thing is, this morning we were also able to attend the Crime Alert Berks breakfast, which was at the Rentner Center. And just want to congratulate the award winners there. Crime Alert Berks does a great job in helping to solve crimes here in Berks County. So I thank them and their board for the work that they put into helping to keep Berks County safe and solving crimes here in Berks County. This weekend, there are a few events. I just want to go over them in case anyone is available. This Saturday from 10 to 3 p.m. at Penn State Berks is the Guts and Glory event that has to do with health holistically, mental health, physical health, emotional health. There's different events that go on, vendors there that talk about health. So if you have the chance, please go by Penn State Berks between 10 and 3. We also have the Sober Stock event at Easy Does It, and that is between 12 and 3 p.m. And that's an event there where you have different organizations who deal with recovery. It's an event, it's a dry event. There's bands there, and there's music, there's different games and so forth. And it's to help celebrate people who are in recovery. So again, if you are in recovery and want to help celebrate, Sober Stock at Easy Does It this Saturday from 12 to 3. And in Kempton, they are celebrating their 150th anniversary. And the events start at 1 p.m. on Saturday. They have a whole host of events starting at 1 p.m. running through about 7 or 8 p.m. that night. And it is at the Kempton Community Center. And the one last event is this Sunday is the 5th Annual Berks Cultural Diversity Festival at City Park in Reading from 12 to 6 p.m. So a lot of events to go to this weekend. And enjoy your weekend. Just a few items on elections that I went over this morning at the election board meeting, but just want to remind everyone, the election is coming up in a little under 6 weeks from now. The registration deadline to register to vote is October the 21st. The deadline to request a mail-in ballot is October the 29th. But please, if you do want to vote by mail-in ballot, do not wait to the 29th. It'd be hard till the time they get it, process it, mail it out, you receive it, and try to mail it back in. Chances are the ballot will not make it unless you drop it off at one of the drop boxes. We also have an over-the-counter ballots you can get. That's primarily for people who might be traveling out of the country and need to vote quickly because they won't be around on November the 5th and they don't have time to wait for a mail-in ballot. If that is your case, you can get the ballot right there at Election Services. They'll print the ballot out for you. You can fill it out right there and hand it back in. If you are doing the over-the-counter ballot, we ask that you do not request a mail-in ballot online. They would have to cancel it anyway and redo the process when you get there. So if you need an over-the-counter ballot, walk in. They will help you through the process, filling out the application. Same application as you would do for a mail-in ballot. But they will process it right there and give you the ballot so that you can vote it right there. I want to give a shout out to our election staff workers. They've been working long days. They've been working Saturdays as well, trying to get everything ready for the election. So shout out to them and the great work that they do. I actually had an interview today from a Spanish, and when I mean Spanish, from Spain, a Spanish news media outlet. And they asked me if I felt that the elections were safe. And I said, absolutely. I said, in Berks County, our election staff, they do a great job. They work hard to make sure that we have safe and secure elections here in Berks County. So I just want to make everyone aware of that. A few other items there is there just recently elections office received about 1,200 registrations ballot registrations, voter registrations. A lot of them were either incomplete or duplicate voter registration. So if you are working with an organization or know of an organization that is working to get people to register to vote, please ask them to have the application completed completely and verify that they're not doing an application for someone that already has, that already is registered to vote. All that does, it delays the processing down in election services. And that is all I have right now. So back to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Commissioner Rivera. We'll move now to Commissioner Dante Santoni.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Welcome back. You've been back temporarily, but we're good. We're glad you're back here in person. We go to a lot of the same things, so I got to make sure I don't repeat what Commissioner Rivera said. So first of all, I do want to thank the supervisors and their staff here, Supervisors Kobosky and Steingraber, along with Kim, your staff, who have invited us here and been great hosts. We really appreciate coming out here and learning a little bit about Ohlone Township and visiting as well. So thank you so much for having us. As Commissioner Rivera mentioned, he talked about the town hall that we had up at the Fleetwood Library, ended up in the CAF, I think. Almost got locked out, but we made it. I have to talk about one of the issues. The issue that got the most discussion is the issue of property taxes. And being a former legislator, I heard about that issue for a long time, but I just want people to know that as county commissioners, we don't have a whole lot to say about how property taxes are levied. It's the school district and the local municipalities. It has to come from the state. Our state representatives and senators have to make changes to that. So, but we entertain those questions, and we not only gave our message, but we listened and we had a lot of good feedback from the residents of that community. So I want to thank and thank Stephanie for allowing us to be having our town hall meetings at libraries throughout our great county. I also had the opportunity to go to an event at Opportunity House, the Second Street Learning Center. Governor Shapiro was there, talking about the cost of child care and how important it is, and not just for people that need the child care, but also for the business community and others. Child care is a huge cost, as many people that have young children know. So he was there signing a bill that will help with some funding and create some tax credits and tax incentives for businesses to give their employees some help with regards to child care. So I want to thank Governor Shapiro for coming into Reading for that. A couple items that are coming up. I don't want to repeat what Commissioner Rivera went over, but on Friday at the Commissioner's Boardroom at the Services Center will be the R3 graduation ceremony. R3 stands for Rebuilding Reentrance and Reading. It's a program through Connections Work. Connections Work is an organization that helps people to come out of prison, get their act together, provide them with the resources they need to get a job and be productive members of our society. They do a great job. They have one every couple, 3 months, something like that. So for this Friday at 10 a.m. is the next graduation ceremony. Young men and women that have been through the program, been out of prison, been through the program, tell their stories. And it's a great event that I've had the opportunity to be at, and I'll be there this Friday at 10 a.m. Friday evening, the Reading Public Library Foundation is having Cocktails and Classics at the Doubletree from 6 to 9:30. And of course they do a great job there. They raise money for the library and their foundation. So that's something I will be at. And you talked about Guts to Glory, another event coming up, CASA of Berks County. CASA stands for Court Appointed Special Associates for Children. They provide, I'm going to make sure I get this correctly. Court-appointed special advocates are volunteers who pledge to stay with their kids until he or she is in their forever home or reunited into a safe family setting. And they do a great job, and they're having their event on September the 28th, which is Saturday from 5 to 8 at Building 24. And the only other thing, the last thing I have is just a dovetail on what Commissioner Rivera said. On Sunday, the Berks Cultural Diversity Festival is having their event at City Park from 12 to 6. And Berks County Economic Development Team, Pam Bennett, will be there. We have a stand there to provide resources in case people are interested. So that's all I have. And thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, Commissioner Santoni. Just a few items I want to touch on. I haven't been much of anywhere for the last 4 weeks. I'm recovering from knee replacement surgery, and I will be at a meeting tomorrow at 10 a.m. Actually, I'm doing WEEU feedback with Bill Saunders. I'll be talking about elections, talking a little bit about our budget, talking about the Reading Regional Airport budget, where the Reading Regional Airport is on an October 1 fiscal year. So I'm going to be sharing some great news about the airport budget and great news about the Reading Aviation FBO budget. Both of them are in the black, and that's a good place to be. One other thing I want to share. Last evening, I went to my first event in almost 4 weeks, and I'm going to see if I can share this picture, and I may not be able to. I'll try one more time here. Do the screen. My wife is executive director of the Office of Technology and Innovation for DCED. She has been there, I believe, 12 years. Prior to that, she worked for what was then the Berks County Chamber of Commerce, and that's where she connected with DCED. Last night, she was awarded the 2024 Impact Award Public Sector for Women in Technology. People that know my wife, she is not a person that goes around and talks about herself and all the great things that she does, but the people that she serves all across the Commonwealth, she works a lot with the higher eds. Places like Carnegie Mellon University on a lot of their technology, and she works with the Ben Franklin groups, five of them across the Commonwealth. Every time I run into any of them, they tell me how amazing my wife is, and I just want to acknowledge how amazing I think my wife is. I'm extremely proud of her accomplishments. That is all that I have. Any comments from our row officers? Public comment. No public comment in person. There's no public comment online. That brings us to the end of our agenda.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
The meeting stands adjourned.